Welcome back, everyone, for our seventh practice talk at this year's Process Mining Camp. Our speakers today are Harm Hoenberger and Redmar Dreisma. Welcome, Harm and Redmar.
Thank you. Welcome. Good to be here.
It's great to have you. Harm, I heard that you actually had some classes with Will van Aalst at the university. Did you learn any process mining from him back then?
I think when I studied at the university, process mining was, in the first step. So I got familiar there, but I think the part, Will was also one of my supervisors in my graduation project, but it was about workflow management. Okay. So I get some glimpse about process mining, but I haven't had lecture for him about that at that time.
Right.
But I followed the developments ever since, and I'm still looking for opportunity to use it within my own organization now. And this is what I've done at Freo, introduce process mining again.
That's great. That's great. So how long have you been, both of you have been doing process mining now?
I think it's been two years since Harm dragged me into this and enjoying it ever since. Yes.
Okay, perfect. Now, we were really curious about your presentation. Your talk will be about combining operational management with process mining. And I know a lot of people are interested in this subject. So please get started with your presentation now.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for your invitation. I think Redmar and I are very excited about this opportunity to share our story in Process Mining Camp. But first, I want to thank all previous speakers. I really enjoyed watching your inspiring stories, and I hope you will also enjoy our story. Our story is about how we use operational management within Freo to steer our day-to-day business, and how we use process mining on top of that to further improve our processes. In my opinion, key to the success of Freo is our mindset to try to do things better for our customers every day. Before I start the story, we'll start with a short introduction of myself. Redmar will introduce himself later on this presentation. My name is Harm Hoenberger, and for more than 2 years, I'm the COO of Freo. This implies that I'm responsible for all the operational teams within Freo. Before becoming a CEO, I have had many change management roles. My most recent change management role was the responsibility over a team of business change specialists, in which we were responsible for the entire change calendar. Our biggest accomplishment, of which I'm still very proud of, is the implementation of the Lean and Agile way of working. And my experience gained there, I'm now using as a CEO. As a change manager, you all advise business manager how to improve the process, including their own way of working. And as was recognized in previous presentations, also for me, it was always a challenge to get the real focus and dedication to follow up my advice. But now that I'm responsible for the operation domain myself, this focus and dedication is no longer an issue. And I'm able to implement my vision about how to run operational teams. And as you can imagine, for me, that's real great fun. And let's be honest, running an operation in a company with high growth ambitions is a change project itself. So for everyone struggling to get process mining embraced within your organization, I already have one advice. Start with using process mining to fix a problem that is keeping your business manager awake at night. Do not start with giving him an extra problem of which he was not aware of before. In the next 20 minutes, I will start with a short introduction of Freo. After this, I will share my vision about KPIs and how we use them within our operational teams. Redmar will continue our story by explaining his vision about data management and how we use different tools within Freo for different purposes, and will demonstrate the mining of our core process in Disco. And I will conclude the presentation by explaining what we've done with those insights. Let's start with introducing Freo. Let's look. Freo is an online consumer loan provider active on the Dutch market. We provide personal loans and revolving credits from 5,000 euro till 75,000 euro to consumers. The main loan goals for which our customers borrow money are a car, a home improvement or refinancing other loans. Online implies that you only can request for a loan via our website, freo.nl, or via a comparison site such as Independer or Pricewise, or via telephone. In the online consumer market, as you can imagine, price is key. And with 3.8%, we currently have the most competitive price in the market. And we can only keep our prices low by keeping focus on our operational costs and continuously improving our processes. At Freo, our core process is our loan application process. This process consists high level out of 5 steps. The first step is a customer applying for a loan via internet or phone. The second step is that the customer is called by our customer contact team. Our call agent asks for additional information to be able to prepare a loan offer and informs the customer which supporting documents he or she needs to deliver to be able to assess his loan request. After this, the customer uploads all requirement documentation, such as passport, salary slip and bank statement. Document validation department checks if all requirement documents are provided and have all requirement document of all required information included in it. If all required documentation is complete, the loan request is transferred to the credit assessment team. This team assesses the loan application and decides whether or not to grant the loan. If the decision is positive, the contract is activated and the money is transferred to our customer. To give you a little bit of insight in the volumes of this process, we receive more than 100,000 loan applications per year. We get more than 20,000 incoming phone calls and more or less than 60 FTE are working in this process divided over the three teams. When starting as a CEO at Freo, my job was two-folded. First, to stabilize the operation department and to ensure that the operational teams are no longer the bottleneck for growth. To set the context, when I started 2 years ago, sales was requested to cut down the inflow of loan requests because the operational teams were not capable in handling them. The second goal is to further drive process improvements. And in my opinion, preconditional for sustainable continuous process improvement is a stable process and a stable organization. Therefore, my primary focus was on getting in control of our processes. Before explaining how we did this with Freo, I will first share you some theory about KPIs. I've been learned that KPIs can be divided into five types of KPIs. These are quality, timeliness, productivity, cost and benefits, and member and customer satisfaction. And I've been learned that focusing on the blue KPIs will automatically have a positive effect on the orange KPIs. In other words, focusing on quality, timeliness and productivity will result in more happy members and happy customers and will result in lower cost and higher benefits. So this is what we have done. For the entire end-to-end process and for all underlying sub-processes, we have set KPIs on quality, timeliness and productivity. And we've implemented measures to be able to proactively steer upon them. I will illustrate this with an example and explain how we monitor our KPIs within different levels in the organizations. Let's use the timeliness KPI as an example. Different levels in the organization need different information to steer upon. For the timeliness KPI, my management team is primarily interested in the total throughput time for receiving a loan application till the contract is activated. The KPI present on MT level is normally not fully recognized by an individual member working in a specific team. And more important, can be fully implemented by that member or team. A team only has limited influence on the total throughput time, but do have influence on the throughput time within the team. For my team leaders and members, it's better to focus on the performance of their team and therefore have set up performance indicators per team. For example, for the customer contact team has a process indicator from receiving the loan application until customer contact. The document validation team from receiving the documents till they have validated the documents, etc. However, these indicators are a visualization how we have performed in the past. This means that if the throughput time is increased and we have not already implemented mitigation actions, we are in fact too late. I want to be able to anticipate if a KPI is potentially under pressure. Therefore, in our day-to-day operations, we steer upon steering indicators. For example, for the timeliness KPI, the net inflow is important. An unexpected increase of loan applications may result in increasing throughput times. Also, our 24-hour promise is an important indicator. If we are not succeeding in responding within 24 hours, this is also a signal that we need to act. Acting on these steering variables is key to stay in control of our process. This implies when the steering variable is turning red, we already should have mitigating actions in place. And mitigating actions are, for example, canceling or postponing team meetings or project meetings, or request support from other teams. And the team itself know when to make use of these mitigating actions. And the nice thing about knowing to be in control over the steering variables, this automatically implies that the process indicators are okay. And this again implies that our KPIs are okay. We use Power BI to create our dashboards. Every day, me and my colleagues get the updated information on our phones. We have an MT dashboard with the KPIs relevant for MT, In this picture, you see one of the visuals in RMT dashboard, in this case, the visual on throughput time. Also, every team has its own team-based dashboard with relevant information for the team. In the team dashboard, the performance indicators are visualized, but also the steering variables. In this way, we have implemented operational visual management in Freo. This works pretty well for being and staying in control, and this enables us to continue delivering our customer promise. However, this does not explicitly make process improvements visible, and here process mining comes into the picture. Redma will demonstrate our loan application process via Disco, but before doing this, we'll first share Freo's vision about data and data management, and we'll explain which tool we use for which purpose. And to be honest, I could have not done all this without Redma, who not only shared my enthusiasm about steering upon data and process mining in particular, but also has access to all data and has the technical capabilities to transform this data into useful insight. Redma, the floor is yours.
Thanks, Harm. Let me first quickly introduce myself. So my name is Redma, I'm 31 years old and I'm living in Eindhoven. And my background is actually in organization sciences, which is a rather sociological view of organizations. And after my studies, I ended up working for Freo, and I started analyzing and providing reports for management and other stakeholders. And I soon found out that the data is far more easy to understand than sociological analysis of organizations. So I have a lot of fun till now. And I've been part of Freo's portfolio and data management team since December of 2019. So let me just quickly give you an introduction to what portfolio and data management actually does. And since December of 2019, me and my colleague have been responsible for managing Freo's portfolio. And since our portfolio is increasing every month, and a few had been done with the data generated by our core systems prior to the start of our team, we really had work cut out for us. And our main goals are to analyze, report, and advise, preferably in that order, to our stakeholders. And our stakeholders are not limited to the management team. And for example, Harm, we are also a business partner of the team leads, and we also support the scrum masters of our IT department. We came from a situation where ad hoc reporting really was the norm, and structured analysis of Freo's data wasn't really commonplace. And when we started, we really formalized a lot of our processes and started to provide structured analysis. Everyone in the summer camp will probably understand banning ad hoc reporting from our daily jobs in a cooperative environment is really as likely as hell freezing over. So not only myself and my colleague discover new doors to open, but also the management team also a lot of questions and other doors for us to open. Of course, we are engaged in multiple projects. One interesting project to mention here is the digitalization of our application process, which we are currently calling Get a Loan Without a Paper. Our job is really defined in a slide that's presented right now. So what you can see is we have we provide monthly reporting. As like I said, we have a lot of ad hoc and deep dives. Of course, we also have some work that's really required by law. So you can think about the Dutch National Bank. And think about the Dutch AFM, which monitors their financial markets. We also report on long-term trends by monitoring publicly available data. Think about the Dutch Bureau of Statistics, the Dutch National Bank, and especially these weird corona times are very interesting for us to monitor, and so we can provide predictions within our limited means. Finally, we provide our stakeholders with reports and dashboards using Microsoft Power Platform. So how does portfolio and data management of Freo support the management team and the stakeholders? What we do is, when we started, we faced a challenge because due to an organizational change, we were forced to reevaluate our data warehouse. We used to have an in-premise data warehouse, but following developments around us, we choose to venture into the cloud. Looking at the slide that's presented right now, you can see the tasks cast upon our team, and all these tasks are basically really easily performed within the Microsoft Power Platform. For our operational reporting, we are currently using a dimensional data model within Microsoft Azure. And the advantage of this dimensional model is that every aspect, every dimension, and every fact go through a thorough validation process, which means that the reports and the dashboards that we create will always have reliable data. Like I said earlier, ad hoc analysis are a fact of life, and sometimes we still have to write queries to get data from our systems. We do this by using transactional SQL in the Server Management Studio. Power BI also has some very powerful tools to either use the data model or sets created by the queries. And using Power BI, we can easily analyze that data and use this in our advising towards our stakeholders. What does all of this have to do with process mining? Let me explain. One major drawback of using dashboards to monitor day-to-day business is tunnel vision, because when you're only focusing on KPIs, there's always the possibility to be blinded by the stuff you're not focused on. And so this is why, and this is where process mining comes in our organization. Well, as Harm already told you, he's responsible for a few teams. And each team is responsible for their own slice of the process pie. You can see this on this slide presented right now. We have the customer contact team, we have the customer validation team, and we have the customer credit assessment team. And let's just look at a brief video where I can explain our process a little bit better. Let's see if this works. Yes, I think it's running. Yeah. So as you can see, our applications can either enter via the phone or via web. And so they will enter our queue for our customer contact team. And afterwards, if we are able to send the customer an offer, they will transfer to the queue that's basically built to check in on the customer if they're still interested. And if the customer sends their offer back to us, they will enter the validation queue. And within the validation queue, we will check the documents and we can determine if we can proceed with the loan, yes or no. And you can see it's a bit of a spaghetti, and that's caused by a different queue we have, and that's called the incomplete queue. And the incomplete queue, I think it's somewhere around here. Sorry, the text is a bit small, but I presume it's around here. And in the incomplete queue, we use it to call the customer because we were missing a document or something like that. So let's go to the next slide. As you can clearly see, as you clearly saw in the video, we have a few remarkable bottlenecks. And these bottlenecks are not explicitly present in the dashboards because they have become background noise. And the first thing we did was look at the touch points. You can see some of the bottlenecks right here. Some other here, over here. So what we did is we looked at the touch points, and we immediately discovered a major limitation in our data because we used the agent name as a resource. And that, of course, has the limiting effect that it was not possible to immediately determine what department was responsible for each bottleneck. And using Microsoft Power Platform, we were able to mitigate the shortcoming by using a Power App to couple the agent to his or her respective department. And let's focus on one blob, and that's this one. It's called the validation process. And we noticed that a lot of work in this queue was delayed because two of our main teams worked within the same queue. Our document validation team is responsible for preparing the and checking the documents before it, before they are sent to the credit acceptance team. And so how it worked in practice was if the document validation team was okay with a particular document, they would leave a remark and they would change a time stamp within the queue. So the credit acceptance team knew, okay, we are up now, so we can start working. This bottleneck caused unnecessary delays because it required manually changing contact dates and also submitting manual remarks. More than once, a customer had to wait necessarily long because, from human error. A concrete solution was to split our validation queue, creating a new queue, especially for the credit acceptance team. This really helped us because it reduces the spaghetti in the process map as well. So what exactly is Disco's advantage over Power BI? Start the filtering is leaks out of Power BI, and the visualization is very well done. And of course, and it has been said before on the summer camp, the video rendering really provides a useful tool to trigger stakeholders to think about and reevaluate their slice of the process. So to reiterate, by using Disco, we were able to find shortcomings within our data, which we could fix using Microsoft Power Platform. We were then able to create a new map, which led to a concrete change in our daily operation. We are currently using Disco periodically to monitor changes in our process, and where Power BI provides day-to-day information, Disco is really a really powerful mirror for us to look into for our organization. Finally, using the process map shown in the video, Harm will now provide a few other examples and summarize our views on the synergy between operational management and process mining.
Yes, thank you, Radmar. It's always fun to show the animation to my colleagues and our management team. It immediately creates a sense of excitement to actually see the yellow balls, in our case loan applications, flowing to the process. But the green part of the picture now is our happy flow. And when I show them the happy flow and the enormous waste still in our process, it also creates a sense of urgency to further improve our process. And I always use this picture to plot our process improvements on, and I want to walk you through 6 process improvements which we already have implemented or are still working on. The first big waste are customers who apply for a loan but never answer the phone when we try to call them. We have analyzed this behavior and figured out that these customers who are thinking about financing a purchase via loan but do not have an urgent loan wish at the specific moment. What we do want is that at the moment the loan wish becomes urgent, Freya is again top of mind. Therefore, we are developing a prospect contact program to ensure that these prospects are periodically reminded with Freo. The second big waste are customers who receive an offer but never send this offer back. We have piloted if a more proactive follow-up of these applications would be beneficial. It turned out that not only the number of returned loan offers increased, but also we got feedback that the extra reminder call was well appreciated. Now we have included this proactive follow-up in our process. These two examples illustrate that continuous process improvement is not only about doing things more efficient. It can be applied to all KPIs and can also be used to generate more sales and happier customers. A first waste is customers calling about the status of the loan request. And as you can imagine, we receive these kinds of calls mostly in busy times. In other words, in times we're already struggling to respond to every phone call. What we have done is we have implemented track and trace functionality in our MyFreo environment, in which the customer can see the status of his loan request and expected date will inform him about if his loan is accepted. Another waste is getting the voicemail of our customer. In our current process, we take the initiative to call the customer, and this moment is not always convenient. With the call me now or call me later functionality, the customer can indicate what the most convenient time for him or her is to be called. A next example, and a major waste in our process, and Redmond already touched upon that, is the incomplete part, the big spaghetti part in the middle of this picture. In 70% of the loan requests, customers are not able to upload all requirement documentation completely and correctly. And especially the bank statement is in many cases not properly uploaded. We now are figuring out how we can better explain to our customers what information we need. And we are hopeful that with the new PSD2 legislations, in which the customer can allow us to retrieve the bank statement directly at his bank, we can decrease the incompleteness. This is still a real frustration of our customers and for us. A last example of process improvements which we're working on is combining the activities of document validation and credit assessment. Currently, first the colleague of document validation opens all documents and verifies if all requirement information is available. And later on, a colleague of credit assessment opens these documents again and looks at this information to assess the application. For a simple loan request, we already combined both activities. And we're also thinking of doing this for more complex applications. I hope these examples will give you some insight in what we have done or are doing with the insights we get from process mining. We are continuously busy with further improving our processes. We use the dashboards of Power BI to monitor if our improvements have effect. And every 3 to 6 months, we mine our process again to see if we see new process improvement opportunities arise. This way, we've managed to handle 20% more loan application every year within the same or less costs. To summarize our story, we use operational management dashboard to run the daily business and to ensure to deliver our customer promise. Key is to have mitigating action in place to be able to anticipate when KPIs are under pressure. We use process mining as initiator and catalyst of process improvement, because the simulation of the process creates a sense of excitement to visualize the actual process and makes waste and bottleneck explicitly visible, and therefore creates a sense of urgency to resolve them. I hope you have enjoyed our presentation and thank you for watching. If you have any questions, do not hesitate to ask them. Redmar and I are looking forward to answering them. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you both. Thank you for this great presentation. It gives a really good overview and I think it's an inspiring story for many of the people watching the camp presentations right now. I see already in the community there's some questions and some discussions already ongoing. I've also been curious, Harm, you started your presentation with a piece of advice where you said that you would say that someone starting out with process mining should not place an additional burden on the business manager, right, by giving them an extra project on top of their busy schedule. I think that makes a lot of sense. At the same time, I can see that if you're learning a new technology like process mining, sometimes it can also be a little bit distracting if you, for example, want to show people like how something works if they immediately are confronted with their own data. Is that also something that you recognize, or you're squarely in the camp of looking at the most important process first, let's say?
No, I've, in my opinion, there are always too many process improvement opportunities. So there will always be a choice and a focus which to start with and which to implement first. So I think also in my change management background, it's very important to use the momentum or mm-hmm. get the right dedication and focus to be able to really implement a change. So it would be really helpful if you can do something which is keeping a business manager awake and which he still not have a problem with.
Right. And I see what you mean. So there's not just this one problem, but there's always multiple things you can approach, and you can maybe pick a little bit an easier one or a one that's a little bit more limited in scope to get started with, but it can be still relevant, and that should be a criteria to select it. Okay, that's good advice. Another thing I was curious about is you showed nicely how you're actually looking at the KPIs on these different levels, and that you're essentially steering and also analyzing with the data analysis and the process mining. You're analyzing on the process level, so KPIs on the process level, for example, case durations or waiting times and things like that can be very clearly measured. But then the goal would be to have an impact on maybe more softer metrics like customer satisfaction. I'm curious, you mentioned that in this process, the focus was very much on growth. Do you think there's a difference if the focus or the goal is growth if compared to, for example, the major focus on cost cutting? Or do you think ultimately the approach will be the same?
No, what I try to explain is that by focusing on throughput time, capacity, productivity, or quality, it will automatically implies that you get more happy customers and more happy members, and also that the benefits will arise, so you can grow. And I think doing your process better, for example, to decrease the throughput time, most cases imply that you decrease the waiting time of a customer, so you get a happy customer. So to focus on that, I think you get more happy customer and at the end, more happy business. I truly believe that happy customers plus happy members will let the company grow.
Yeah, and like you mentioned also, you have to actually be competitive, right, to enable the growth. So that's, again, like another angle for the whole measurement. Redma, one thing I was curious about is you mentioned the validation queue that had to be split up yes. after the analysis. So was this a surprise to the people you showed this to, or was there already perhaps some kind of gut feeling that someone already had the suspicion but couldn't just place it and it was confirmed?
I must admit it was not the most novel idea, because the idea was already started when we started using the software we use currently. But it was really a nice, basically a confrontational moment when I showed them, look, there are a lot of customers waiting in the queue because, someone made an error. So when I showed them the animation, it was basically like, we got to do it right now. So I think it basically sped up the process, yes.
Okay, yes. And you mentioned the deep dives that are being done periodically as an addition to the continuous measurements. How often are you doing those deep dive analysis right now?
It's the intention that we want to do basically one deep dive per quarter. So once in the 3 months, yes.
Okay. Yes, as a follow-up analysis and to see how things are going. Okay, great. Now maybe to close the circle. So Harm, you started out by explaining that your background is coming from the lean and from the change management field, so that you're really passionate about this and you have a lot of experience about this. So what would be your estimate, and that's actually a question Frank was raising in the Slack community just now, is like from the lean professionals, which of course is quite an established discipline and much older and more established than process mining, which is a much younger discipline. What would be your estimate how many lean professionals are maybe aware of process mining and using process mining, and do you see a trend in this development?
Oh, that's a difficult question. What I'm still thinking is very strange, because process mining is out there for many years already, but you don't see many companies really using it, and that is really will be embedded in process improvement. So in my opinion, it will be a great benefit to all lean initiatives and to see how we can do things better. Mm-hmm. But I do not know what the exact reason is why people don't pick it up. So to do an estimation, I've clearly no idea. I think it will still be way too less. Mm-hmm. And I think many more lean enthusiasts and being busy with process improvement, I think should have this tool in his backpack.
Yeah. Okay. So still some education work to be done to let people know this exists and to show how it can be integrated with the lean approaches.
Yeah.
All right, I think that's a good place to end for today. So everyone, please go to the Freyo channel in our Slack community, continue the discussion there, and we will have Harm and Redma back tomorrow to answer your questions in more detail. Thanks, everyone. Okay. See you tomorrow. Thanks,
Harm. See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Back everyone for the last day of this edition of Process Mining Camp. Like every day, we start with our daily Process Mining Cafe, where we welcome back the speakers from the previous day. Welcome back, Harm and Redma.
Thank you.
Good to be here.
All right, so let's dive directly into the discussion based on what people have asked and discussed in our Slack community. And one of the questions Rien was wondering about, he wanted to know whether you have considered RPA or AI, whether you have that on your roadmap. And he was wondering, for example, about chatbots who could address some of the follow-up or document chat checks. Is that something you have been looking into?
We have looked into robotics, but at this point I see no added value for Freo, and for two reasons. And as Redma yesterday touched upon, we are currently experimenting with retrieving data from data sources. We are able to retrieve the income from the governmental organization, also the PSD2 legislation allows us to retrieve the bank statement data directly at the bank. And this implies, of course, after customer approval, that customers do not need to upload their salary slip and bank statement anymore. At this point, you're already able to get the data. The next step is to create models to be able to automatically access a loan request. And this will have major impact on our process. Our focus now is to further develop this, in other words, in automating our process instead of robotizing it.
Okay.
The second reason is that the phone call our call agents do is highly appreciated by our customers. This phone call gives Freo a face because we are an online organization and gives the customer the trust that they are dealing with the real company. And for customers getting a loan, this is a big decision with a long-term commitment. So in my opinion, there will always be a real call somewhere in the process. So I don't want to robotize or automate this part of the process.
Right. So also a chatbot is not, it's just not something that can replace the person who's talking to the customer in this situation.
Never replace. Chatbots we are looking at. Mm-hmm. But in my opinion, then the experience a customer has with our chatbot should be similar than contact your agent. You know, I want to prevent that every second question with a chatbot is make us speak to a human being. So if you decide to use chatbots, I want to make sure they are a good alternative of talking to our call agents.
Right. Okay, so yeah, some other things people have wondered about is also about the periodic redirection that you're doing with the deep dives that you're doing every 3 months, like you explained yesterday, Redma. So Brian really liked the idea, but for example, Johan was also wondering, is it really needed to do like a new analysis every 3 months if there's not a big change in the process, like a change in regulation or a new type of loan? What do you think about this?
I do agree with the fact that it could be overkill to check a process every 3 months. However, the process is like Harm touched upon before, there are some changes coming and some changes already happened. And besides that, it's not really that much of a burden to do another analysis after 3 months. Because we can basically just use the queries we have already made. So it's basically really like importing the data set again, using the recipes we created in Disco in the analysis we did before. And it's more like, I think a good analogy would be a kind of an anchor. So you can check every 3 months, okay, are we doing what we're supposed to be doing? And are the changes doing what we expected them to do?
Right. So it's an easy way to check again, and it's not much work if you have done the analysis once.
Exactly.
You can easily repeat it and check the direction. Okay. Can you maybe explain a little bit more about the way of working? Is this something that you just do yourself, or are you doing this with a team or in a workshop setting? Coming back a little bit to the kind of different ways of working that we've discussed last week with after Nelika's presentation, for example. So maybe you can talk a little bit more about this.
Regarding process mining, that's basically on my desk. And of course, we perform multiple deep dives, and so my colleague is also responsible for that. But the process mining is really at my my responsibility. Yes.
So you are in the driver's seat. You are doing these repeated analysis, and if any interesting results come up based on those, you're going into the discussion with the responsible people about it.
Yeah, and
Exactly.
I think I'm Redmo's biggest sponsor, so I'm very curious about this outcome and to share it with me and with my team lead.
Yeah.
Yes.
So he has the support there with these announcements.
Very much, very much.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, going a little bit more into the technical aspects. So some people were also wondering, or asking some more questions about the KPIs and how you are measuring things. So, for example, Markus was wondering whether you're looking at pure averages or also looking, for example, at the median or thresholds, like, for example, 90% of the orders are being done in a certain range. What would you say to Markus about this?
I do agree with Markus that the average is not the best measure you can take, but for us, it's mostly about the 24-hour promises, especially in the loan application process we discussed yesterday. And for that, it's basically more like, okay, every team has 24 hours to perform their part of the process by. So it's just basically, it's really like zero or one. So yeah, it's more like how we measure that one. Mm-hmm. But for other processes, we do use medians, yes.
Okay, yeah. And he was also wondering how you're handling situations where the service time, or let's say the business hours, are not 24/7. So sometimes they are limited working hours. Do you take this into account, or is this not relevant for this process?
Yes, we do that. We do take that into account. Yes, yeah.
Okay.
We have. We have some measures for that in Power BI we can use, yes.
Okay, and so is that, so when you're saying 24 hours, but this is calendar time, right? So the what you just explained, like from one touch point to the other, it should not be more than 24 hours. This is calendar time and not working time, or?
Okay. No, it indeed is calendar time, yeah.
Okay, and are there other places where working time does play a role? So in other, are there other SLAs which have like a within a business day or something like this requirement? Not really.
No, not really.
Okay.
Yeah, but Redmar, I think we skipped the weekend days in our 24-hour promise, so only the days we are open.
Ah, okay.
Yes. Yeah, and holidays are also excluded, yes.
Right. Oh yeah, and in Disco you can do this too, right? With the demo. Right. Okay, so let's see. So maybe also related to the KPIs. So Rudy, for example, was wondering, how did you organize the update and commitment to the new KPIs when you're implementing a change? So that's, of course, then involving the people who are working in the process. If there's new KPIs that you establish, relates to the change management rather than the measurements themselves. So do you have anything to add about this?
Yeah, I think in my opinion, KPIs should not change when you implement a change. I think when I started here, the KPIs were not specifically set. This is what we've done to steer on KPIs. But I think your KPIs should be fixed, and with change, the only thing you can change is possibly the target. But then I do not like changing target setting directly after the implementation of a change, but I prefer to do it when a situation is stable and we every day we meet the KPI, then to talk to the team and we could see if we could increase this KPI and lead the barrier a little bit higher.
Yeah. That's a really good point. So you already have the KPI and you're measuring it and you're monitoring and checking the improvement with respect to this KPI over time. At the very beginning, it sometimes can be helpful to understand the process in the first place to establish the KPIs and to know what you want to measure to steer the process. But in your situation, I'm curious, did you have the KPI already, was it already known and fixed before you started your process mining analysis, or was that one of the first things that you established with the initial process mining analysis in the beginning?
No, I think it was in parallel, I think. We have, for stabilizing the organization, we have set the KPIs.
Mm-hmm.
And as explained yesterday, we use KPIs on quality, timeliness, and productivity. And with process mining, we just we used it to visualize the process, just not to steer up on its KPIs, but to see opportunities to improve those on those three subjects, but also on the other two KPIs.
Yeah, yes.
I don't think it's really necessary to have KPIs to do process mining. I think it's more, for us, it fits best to see process improvement opportunities.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Indeed.
Yeah, I understand. So that's maybe, yeah, also a nice, yeah, bridge to talk a little bit more about, yeah, the way of working, because process mining, yeah, is not usually completely changing the way of working, but it's integrating into an existing approach. And so for example, with the lean approach in your case, so I'm curious, do you have some more to say about how process mining fits in this way of working already completely, or does it change some parts? And if so, which parts does it change compared to not using process mining, for example, in lean projects?
I think process mining can speed up your improvement projects. Mm-hmm. So it's a good tool to have in place. And if you want to fix a problem, process mining can be used to get the insights. And I think that's one of the tools you can use in every lean project or lean way of working.
Yeah, is there a particular phase in the lean improvement cycle where you think process mining is most useful?
I think in the analysis part.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. Okay, so that's just trying to see that I don't miss any questions. So, for example, Rudy was also wondering about customer journey analysis. Did you do a customer journey analysis for this process?
Yes, we do. What I do like at every change is to really get the voice of the customer. I think that's crucial when changing something. So when we have an issue, I have a small team which I can ask to do, we call it campaigns, but that's just calling the customers and to see how we can do things better. Mm-hmm. And we use that input for our improvements. So I prefer for every project to just ask the customer instead of thinking of the solution ourselves.
Yes. So that's really then closing the loop also for those, for the qualitative feedback, because, so then you know whether you did a good job or not.
Yeah, it's one part of the qualitative feedback. And the first part is making no errors in your process, but also learn of all the feedback you get from your customers.
Right, yes. Did you ever include any of those qualitative numbers, for example, feedback data in the original process mining data also?
No, I've never used this. I think this is more another source of improvements that you can use. So you use the customer, you see your process and process mining. So I see that as another trigger to do things better.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that was also one of the questions in the community was relating to the different KPIs that you were showing at the beginning of your presentation. You had these two levels, so the process level KPIs and then the outcome KPIs. And the outcome would be exactly something like a happy customer or, so for example, qualitative metrics like customer satisfaction, whereas on the process level are the things that are something that you can actually measure, like, for example, the case duration. And someone in the chat was wondering whether you have made some direct correlation analysis between these process level KPIs and the quality outcome KPIs. Did you find any correlation there?
I think that's my philosophy. There is a correlation. I didn't really measure it, but I think if you do things faster, make less errors, and doing things more efficient, that will always have a positive effect on our customer or our member and have a positive effect on our cost and benefits. So that's the philosophy we use, and I cannot imagine that it will have the other way around to have a negative effect.
Yeah.
But maybe the costs and the benefits are easier to pinpoint directly to. Member and customer satisfaction, there are so many things that influence that, so it's very hard to get the direct link.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. So it's really based on the understanding of the process and the knowledge of the customers and the domain that you can make these connections and just
yes.
No, that's true. Is it then, does then process mining help in any way to make a business case, for example, for a particular change, even though the outcome of that change is supposed to and has the goal to, yeah, for example, improve the customer level and the customer satisfaction?
I think it when showing the waste in the process, it do create a sense of urgency. But I since we have transferred from an agile way of working, and that also implies we have fixed teams with fixed budgets, I think the business case is a little bit diminishing. So the product owner is able to see how he gets most business value out of his team, and there will no longer be large business cases made. So I don't think that's in the entire, even within Freo, no longer really necessary to make an extensive business case, but to have some common sense with changes to have most business value at this point.
Right. So do you mean because the cycles are faster and smaller that you have these faster iterations that you don't need to make this big business case because you're working on a smaller scale each time, or?
No, I think it's more about that the budget is fixed, so we don't have to ask for money to change
Okay.
something. There is just one team, and the budget is already granted, and the team is responsible, the product owner is responsible to put the things with most business value on top of his list.
Yeah. Yeah, and the team is already there, and their purpose is to continuously improve and look for ways to do better. Yeah, okay, great.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's maybe a nice bridge to a question that Rien had about how do you actually collect and prioritize the improvement initiatives that come out of the deep dives, but also the manager's wish list. So there's usually more than one thing that you can do. So how do you decide what to implement first?
The prioritization a little bit depends if we can implement the solution ourselves, or that it requires change in our IT systems. And if it IT is just that I told before is that we put it on the back of the change team, and it's the responsibility of the product owner to decide when to implement that. If we can do it ourselves, we seek for the right momentum to implement this change, and preferably as soon as possible. But we know, for example, that in July and August for Freo will be the most busy months for loan applications. So this will not be a good moment to introduce a major change in the process. Every change usually results in a short decrease of productivity, and I always want to have a little bit of overcapacity to absorb a change.
Yes. Yeah. That makes a lot of sense. Okay, great. Well, maybe a good question and a question for both of you to end with today's Process Mining Cafe session is whether there's anything that you would do differently if you would start over again completely right now. Something you have learned.
May you start?
Little bit on the spot.
Well, not one particular thing. Maybe we could, thinking hard about it, but I don't really think. I think we had a good process, and I have a nice sponsor in Harm, as we already discussed. So no, for me, not really. No.
No, for me, I also do not think we would have done things differently. What I do have learned is that I have to be aware of the pace we do to implement things, and that I'm going to make sure that I'm not going too fast and to keep everyone on board. And I think that's something that's really important. So our journey, which I spoke about yesterday, is not something we can do overnight. So, keep track of your fellow members, and
Yeah.
make sure they will keep on board.
That's a good piece of advice. Yeah, so to really keep this in mind, but also make sure you plan in the time to do that on every step on the way to keep them in the loop and explain what you're doing, and so that doesn't go over their head and they're on board. Okay, great. Well, thank you both for coming back today.
You're welcome.
We will continue the discussion a little bit more. So if you have more questions for Harm and Redmar, please ask them in the Freo channel in our Campfire Slack community. We will now go into a brief break, and we will be back quarter to the hour with our talk from today. See you all. See you all then. Thanks, Harm. Thanks, Redmar. Bye-bye.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.